20% of the country's households are over-indebted. It is this debt that has created a whole new industry worth billions of rands per month. This is called securitization, as practiced by mainly the four major banks in the country.
Securitization is where their loan is sold to a third party. In other words, a lot of people go to the bank, they complete their credit applications, and through that credit application obtains a loan. Now, that credit application is then packaged with other loans, right? Boxed together and then sold.
But why would a bank sell a credit to a third party? Brendan Aramse of the Securitization Forum, which buys this debt from financial institutions, explains.
You're lending out money 20 years to somebody to buy a house, okay? Yes. But I'm funding my bank on, let's say, a three-month basis. And I think this is part of what securitization has tried to do, is to say we match the asset with actually the funding, because that's what we do in terms of securitization, that there's no liquidity risk for the bank in it.
To understand this concept further, I meet up with a group of debt counselors in Cape Town. I want to know if my debt can be sold to the highest bidder at a profit.
Anything that is a loan can be securitized. And I was advised that most debt in South Africa is securitized.
After a consumer's debt is sold to a third party, usually known as a special purpose vehicle, it ends up here at the stock exchange, packaged and resold to investors. But how much can my debt be sold for?
Depends on the type of structure that you actually implement, but typically you would sell those at face value, i.e. the capital value that was advanced, and then if there was some interest, you know, that had accrued at that point in time.
Having amassed quite substantial debt myself over the last decade, from credit cards, car loans and mortgages, I'm interested in finding out how this affects me. My first interest is a Standard Bank issued home loan I took out for a flat in this complex in 2006. And then none put
it. Regrettably, the law has been written in such a way that the consumer has no rights to determine what loan has been sold.
Is it possible that my own bond could now have been sold to someone else? After email exchanges with Standard Bank Home Loans Department, I'm advised to contact their call center.
Hey Peter, how would you like my assistance with regards to your bond account today?
I wanted to know if my home loan is securitized.
Are you referring to insurance on the account?
I'm referring to securitization. I don't know if you understand me.
No, I do not understand you when you're referring to securitization on the account.
Okay. Isn't there somebody who can actually tell me about who understands securitization in the department who might help me?
Please stand the line for me for 2 to 3 minutes, please.
Okay.
Can you just explain to me one more time, because I am inquiring for you on our side.
Okay. I wanted to find out if my loan has been securitized.
Securitized?
Yes. Have you ever heard about that term within the banking industry?
No. And I'm trying to explain it to one of my seniors, but they also a bit confused. So.
With no joy from their call center, I decide to approach my branch. Here again, the consultant does not seem to understand my query.
Let's say if my home loan is secured, somebody just told me that the bank could actually sell it to somebody. Like sell your home loan to somebody else. So then you would only know if you ask the bank.
Sure, okay, I don't know about that. I don't know about that.
So I wanted to find out with, so that
no,
I clearly know.
I would say to sell it to someone else. No, unless you instruct them to, if you can't make your payments or whatever. But I don't know of them just doing it without you.
Just selling it.
No.
Whether you are in arrears or not, they
no.
can just they can just
no.
sell it and.
That doesn't even sound right.
Like,
why would they want to do that?
Yeah, because you see, like, they can sell and get you all the money up front immediately.
Sure, okay.
So that's what I would...
No, that doesn't even sound right, because
yeah,
it's in your name.
Yeah.
Why
yeah.
would we just...
Sell it to somebody.
Without your authority.
No, because
a month later, I'm still no closer to knowing. If my bank's home loan department does not even understand the concept or meaning of securitization itself, who then should I turn to for answers?
So how do you find out who owns your credit? You'll get to know right after this.
In Durban, I meet Louis Law, another consumer like me who has come face to face with securitization. After initially taking a bond with Absa in 2007, he's been hard at work searching for answers.
I chose the troubles. I chose to essentially challenge the banks on their standing or on the validity of our agreement. If they have securitized my loan, then they are not a party of interest and I'm not indebted to Absa.
At stake was this house, which Louis had bought for almost 400,000. So how did he confront his bank?
I requested my original document from the bank through all their various departments, from the home loans department up to the branch itself, to the debt collecting department, and none of these departments, including consultants or branch managers, could provide me with this agreement that I requested.
But why was Louis asking questions? Although evidence shows that he had never defaulted, was he trying to find ways to stop honoring his financial obligations?
I maintained payment right up to it became obvious that Absa Bank could not provide me with this agreement, which is sufficient cause to believe that they might have sold or ceded or securitized my loan to a third company, a third party, and therefore Absa was not a party of interest anymore. And I have no obligation to Absa whatsoever if they couldn't provide me with this agreement.
With anyone that represents Homes, because if I phone the responsible person for Homes, I get to Absa.
And then what was happening with the difference?
After almost a year of being sent from one office to another, Absa finally capitulated. In this letter dated 12 October 2011, almost 5 years since taking the bond, he is told, "Your mortgage bond was transferred from Absa to Home Obligators Mortgage in Hand Securities on 28 November 2007.
I was lucky enough to be able to, after almost a year of questioning, to receive a document from one of the managers in the Home Loans Department which confirms that my loan was sold, which is my proof that Absa is not a party of interest anymore.
But what does the law say? Raymond Dix, an expert on securitization, explains.
Once that sale has taken place, the banks don't have locus standi. In other words, the right to be the credit, the demander of the monies, it is now the SBI that has all these rights. And it is the only one that is entitled to bring legal action against the consumer that has not paid his loan.
You were not injured. Most banks sell this debt to companies known as special purpose vehicles or SPIs, which in turn sell it to investors.
The provisions are 35 or Rule 35(4) that states a sale must take place for a securitization transaction to take place. Now, it also forms logical sense that a SPI actually obtains its capital to buy loans from Johannesburg Stock Exchange, and they gain the money from investors. So the SPI must be in possession of the thing, now the loan, to actually put it on the market and investors to buy into.
It looks as though just this attorney changed the name to Holmes. It was now Holmes creating
the payment
of 410.
It was on 16 May 2012.
With Absa losing its legal rights to the loan, Louis decided to stop paying his bond. Absa did not take it lightly, warning, "We maintain our position that you are legally indebted to Absa. Should you stop your repayments, the bank will take necessary legal action." To understand Absa's legal standing, I decide to seek the help of experts on consumer law and the National Credit Act.
If a bank has securitized that asset, the consumer no longer owes the bank that money. They don't owe the bank that money. That is clear. bank has no standing to sue, and it shouldn't mislead the court and the consumers and the public to say that they've got standing to sue when they clearly do not.
However, Absa went ahead with its lawsuit against Louis regardless. Louis single-handedly challenged their legal standing on the matter, demanding they produce the original bond agreement.
If they could show me the original agreement or a certified copy of the original agreement, I'd have to assume that our agreement is above board, everything is as it should be, and I am indebted to Absa, and therefore I'd have to continuously pay Absa for the remaining terms of my loan.
In its own defense, Absa claims in court papers that the agreement had been lost in a fire. They further confirmed this in an affidavit dated 28 August 2011 that the agreement had been lost in a fire at DocuFire on 28 August 2009. But how could this be when, by its own admission, the bond had already been sold to a third party as far back as 28 November 2007, 2 years before the said fire?
In my research, I've come across quite a few other individuals that's also been told by their banks that their accounts has been destroyed in a fire or misplaced or lost during a move. But there's an abundance of people out there that can't get hold of this contract, which securitization provides to be a valid reason why there's so many missing contracts.
I have personally come across fraudulent documents, not signed by the consumer, documents that have been presented to the court where it is stated that a fire took place and the originals cannot be presented to the court. That is not correct.
In terms of the statistics that are available and the amount of billions that are securitized every month by the banks, it is impossible that the bank is the legal holder to their title every time it sues.
Faced with these questions and evidence in court, Absa entered a motion to withdraw the matter. The letter reads, "Please take notice that the plaintiff hereby withdraws its action against the first and second defendant." Almost immediately, the Special Purpose Vehicle Company, which had bought the bond, filed its own summons against Louis. The matter is still before court.
But most likely, it's the same thing. This third company, Holmes, taking action against me is purely hearsay. It's purely word of mouth. It's purely their opinion. But there's no evidence that we have an agreement standing.
That relationship that must exist contractually between the two parties does not exist. This is now like a pyramid. There is no connection part between the SPI and the consumer.
The whole securitization, if you look at that process, you run it through the National Credit Act and you run it through the Consumer Protection Act with particular reference to Section 42, I believe that it amounts to a fraudulent scheme.
Coming up next, how a Standard Bank client got a rude awakening.
Research shows 25% of car.
In the suburb of North Riding, north of Johannesburg, I meet Marcus. He's not a happy man. He just lost this home to a company he had never heard of before.
I have been cheated. I have been put out by a system which is so smelly it's scary.
Marcus had taken a bond with Standard Bank in 2006. Yet in these court papers, a new company comes onto the scene, suing him for default.
All the statements I have received were coming from Standard Bank Home Loan. And I have subsequently asked how this actually happened or who the company is, Blue Granite Account 2.
The answer comes when he confronts Standard Bank lawyers. In an email exchange, he's told Blue Granite Investment Number 2 is one of the companies of Standard Bank, in effect a subsidiary of Standard Bank of South Africa.
How can this happen? I was never advised. I've been awaiting answers from Standard Bank, which I've been in communication for nearly 3 years, and I never heard anything from Standard Bank.
So how could Standard Bank securitize the loan to themselves? In court documents filed against Markers, Blue Granite claims to be a duly registered commercial bank with branches across the country. Our investigations, however, reveal that Blue Granite is nothing but a special purpose vehicle and not a bank used by Standard Bank in its securitization scheme. But what are the rules governing the relationship between a bank and a special purpose vehicle?
The regulations regarding securitization clearly states that a bank may not have an interest or a partnership with the SBI.
Yet here, the lawyers clearly state that Blue Granite is a subsidiary of Standard Bank. This is the same situation that Louis Law finds himself in over his case against Absa.
This company is still represented by the same responsible people, the same attorneys that APSA used, same responsible people. When trying to get hold of anyone from this third company or Homes, I only get back to APSA.
Even the paperwork filed in court by the new company says Luwilo is indebted to APSA and not to the SPV.
APSA Bank sued initially, and then followed by SPV suing him later on. What is the relationship between the bank and this SPV? That question must be answered by terms of, is there a contract between the SPV and APSA? If there is, surely that contract must be in violation of Section 78 of the Banks Act, because now the bank is acting as an agent.
We found that the banks use a clause in each and every contract to justify their action. This clause gives the bank powers to litigate and even foreclose long after they have securitized the agreement. But how lawful can this be?
That is a strict violation of Section 78 of the Banks Act. Now, Section 78 of the Banks Act is enforceable by the central bank, the South African Reserve Bank. A division of that is the Registrar of Banks. It's their obligation and to fulfill and investigate these complaints. Although being informed about this in our summonses, they have taken no action whatsoever.
The law also strictly forbids a relationship between a bank and special purpose vehicle. However, the securitization forum begs to differ.
As far as this role of administration is concerned, mm-hmm. that basically reduces the bank to acting as an agent, isn't it?
That is correct.
A bank shall not, for the purpose of effecting a money lending transaction directly between a lender and borrower, perform any act in the capacity of an agent.
Mm-hmm.
But you just described the fact that the bank is acting as an agent, isn't it?
Correct. I mean, and that role is specifically provided for in terms of the securitization regulations, that the bank can fulfill those.
The banks have been suing, despite having securitized the assets, have been suing and litigating clients in their own name.
Sure.
When they fully know that this asset has actually been ceded.
I don't think it's that the bank specifically knew that or did that on purpose. The fact that they would have entered into that legal action in the wrong capacity does not mean that the debt doesn't need to be paid anymore. I mean, all that would mean is like you need to start your legal action again, but in the right capacity. And you need to do that in terms of that servicing arrangement or that administration arrangement that you do have. So, yes, there was some teething problem, but as far as I'm aware, you know, all the banks have been actually re-advised and internally made sure, look, guys, you need to make sure we institute this in a right capacity.
What do we do with those cases where the banks have misled the court to believe that they could still continue to have locus standi over, or they still continue to own those mortgages?
Sure. Look, at the end of the day, the bottom line is, if you've borrowed money from the bank,
yes.
you need to repay that money.
Yes.
You've got an obligation to pay that, okay? No matter ultimately to who it now needs to be paid, but I mean that needs to be paid.
If you could imagine for the last decade, the last 10 years, how many houses, vehicles and property were sold off by the banks where they had no locus standi. Those rights will be enforced and claims will be placed against the bank that will supersede the current highest class action you've ever seen.
The banks, and depending on whether the attorneys know or not, they are liable for fraud. And they can be held in contempt of court for perjury. You must understand that when you sue out a summons, you need to state everything that you plead must be stated as a fact. And you need to make sure that everything that you state in your pleadings is the truth. You cannot plead something that is false.
The National Credit Regulator's silence on this matter has been deafening. He stands accused of failing to apply the law to protect the consumer.
According to the National Credit Act of 2005, a register on securitized assets is supposed to be kept here as a matter of public record and promotion of transparency in the industry. However, since the inception of the National Credit Act 8 years ago, that has not been done. We tried to quiz the National Credit Regulator on this issue, but he declined to comment.
We also approached the Registrar of Banks to no avail, while the Bank Ombudsman also gave us the runaround. In its response, and despite securitizing an average 10 billion per month, Standard Bank claims this is just a small portion of its business. It also fails to articulate its relationship with the special purpose vehicle Blue Granite No. 2. Despite evidence to the contrary, APSA claims that if the customer's loan has been securitized, the customer will be advised that their credit provider has changed. This could not be further from the truth.
Now, a part two on securitization will be flighted soon. In that show, we'll invite the National Credit Regulator, the Registrar of Banks, the Ombudsman for Banking Services, and other stakeholders to come and set the record straight. But until then, I'd like to know what you think of this matter. And you can do that via email, Twitter, or Facebook. Well, to end with, I've picked out two comments on last week's show called Praise the Drug Lord on crooked pastors who are involved with drug dealings. Angeline Faltain tweeted, I am speechless after watching the show of what is supposed to be people who work for God. We are no longer safe in the house of the Lord. Shame on the drug lords. And Patricia Herber Facebooked, what is most disturbing is that the hawks say they know about this, but yet they are doing nothing, even after information has been given to them. Well, that's it for tonight. Join us again next week when we point out the issues that matter.